We're at the home this morning of Brenda Bird. My name is Carlton Cartwright. I'm the interviewer. Today's date is October the 21st, 2012. Okay, and let's see. For the record, and we're at the home of Miss Bird, the 720 38th Street in West Palm Beach, Florida. What's the zip code here?
33407.
Okay, 33407. And I'm the executive director of the Children's Coalition Incorporated. And Brenda, what war or branch of the service did you serve in?
I was in the Air Force.
Mm-hmm.
From 1972.
Yes.
Till 1992.
Okay. And what was your rank when you separated?
E6, which is tech sergeant.
And where did you serve?
I served which bases, or because there's lots of bases.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, my first Air Force base was Wurtsmith Air Force Base, which is located in Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
And my second base was Pease Air Force Base, New Hampshire.
Right.
And I served in Beale Air Force Base in California, Osan Air Force Base in Korea, Columbus Air Force Base in Mississippi, what's the other base? Grand Forks Air Force Base in North Dakota, Upper Haver Air Force Base in England.
Okay. Were you drafted or did you enlist?
I volunteered and enlisted in 1972.
Okay. Where were you living at the time?
I was living in Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
Why did you pick that? Why did you pick that service branch to join?
Well, actually, I thought about going to the Navy, but because I couldn't swim and I was afraid of water, so I chose the Air Force.
Do you recall your first days in the service?
I recall the few days, the first day in basic training, which was in Lackland Air Force Base. And the reason I recall it so vividly is because when I went in the Air Force, I was a single mother with two children.
Okay, wow. Okay. So what was basic training like?
Basic training was not that rough because most of basic training is about discipline. Mm-hmm. And I was already disciplined.
When you went in?
When I went in, yes.
So you were used to regimen and...
Oh, yes.
Okay. So tell me about boot camp, anyway.
Boot camp was...
Do you remember your instructors?
Yeah, I remember my instructors. And I also remember because I was the guide on. I'm the one who carried the flag when we marched. So I was probably one of the oldest of my group, because when I went in, I was 23, and I already had been married and had two kids. So it wasn't that difficult. The most difficult part of it was that was the first time that I've been separated from my children.
Okay. Where were they? Back home?
They were back home. My son was being raised by his grandmother, and my daughter at that time was being taken care of by an aunt. But when I first went into the service, when I first joined the service, you couldn't have dependents. You could have children, but you couldn't claim them as dependents. So what I had to do was, not legally, but I had to say that I didn't have any dependents. So that's how my ex-mother-in-law, which is my son's grandmother, and my aunt end up taking care of my children.
Oh, okay.
And then later on, after I was in the service for a while, they had changed the law. Actually, they had changed the rule before I went in, I think, but the recruiter was not aware.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So you were in, what was basic training was what, 6 weeks?
It was 6 weeks, I think. It was 4 weeks or 6 weeks? I think it was 6 weeks.
Six by the time I got in there.
Yeah, well, it was six.
So, I guess what, after basic training, you went to tech school?
Yeah, after basic training, I went to tech school at Lackland Air Force Base.
Okay. Where was basic at?
Basic was at Lackland. Tech school, I went to Shepherd Air Force Base.
And where was that?
I'm not sure what part of
Texas. I can't remember
where
Shepherd is.
Is it Lowry? I don't know. I can't remember which part it was in.
What state was it in?
Texas.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. And how long, what was your AFSC and how long were you there?
Well, when I first went in the Air Force, I was in air traffic control school.
Okay.
But because that was one of those stressful schools, so I ended up not staying in the air traffic control. And so from air traffic control, I went to, I was administration. But then I met Charles, my husband, and he was going to get shipped overseas. And so I didn't want to go and leave Charles, so I changed jobs. And so I went to become an X-ray technician. However, as an X-ray technician, you had to do 6 months at a regional hospital, which meant Charles was going to go to Japan and I was going to be left behind. So I changed jobs again. So I ended up being a dental technician.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so for 17 years, I was a dental technician / dental hygienist.
Wow, okay. Fascinating. Okay, so how long was it? Okay. So how many tech schools did you go to initially?
Three.
Mm-hmm. All right, so how long was your technical training total?
Altogether. Well, once I became a dental...
And was it all at Shepherd or where?
No. Well, air traffic control was at Biloxi Air Force Base in Mississippi.
Okay.
But all the other medical trainings, they were all in Texas. Okay, but once I became a dental technician, and then I moved over to being a periotherapist, which is the same as a dental hygienist, working for a periodontist. So then my last part of the training was in St. Louis.
In Missouri? Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right, so how long was all of that training? Before you finally went to a
because when I became a dental technician, I was really working under a doctor at the time. Mm-hmm. So then I got certified under the doctor, and then for the other part, which I became a periotherapist, then I had to go to St. Louis.
Okay.
So, you know, most of the job for the dental technician was like on the job training, being supervised by a dentist.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. So can you remember how long all of that took you?
It was probably maybe eight years, 9 years, and then I became a trainer myself.
Okay.
So then I trained the new dental technicians that came in on how to be dental hygienists.
All right, so let me see if I can get this straight. After basic training, you went to Shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and how long were you there?
Probably, you know, when you get old, you can't remember the dates.
Take it easy.
I don't know. I probably was there for like maybe 6 weeks.
Okay, and then after that you went to?
And after that I went to, I should have written all this stuff down. I think I went to Wordsmith Air Force Base.
Okay, and where's Wordsmith?
It was in Oscoda, Michigan, but Upper Peninsula near Canada, but that base is closed now. And that's where I met Charles.
Okay, So you were there training for what?
When I left Texas, I went to Mississippi for the air traffic control.
Mm-hmm.
And so when that didn't work out, then I got sent to Michigan for administration.
Right.
And that was like kind of like on the job training type
right.
of thing. And then in that position, I worked in drug and alcohol.
Okay.
Yeah. And so when I left there, that's when I went back to Texas for, oh, I skipped radiology.
Okay.
I skipped that one.
That's okay. Tell me about it.
So the radiology is the one where I had to do the extra 6 months.
Okay.
And then that's when I didn't want to be separated from Charles, so then that's the one that I got out of. And then from there, I ended up being the dental technician.
Right. Okay, so you're back in Texas for radiology.
Yeah.
And how long were you there for that?
Probably 2 months.
All right. And then after that, where did you go?
After that, I went to Beale Air Force Base.
Where's Beale at?
In California.
Okay. Which part? North or south?
Near Sacramento.
Gotcha. Up in the middle north. Okay. Mm-hmm. And how long were you there and what were you there for?
I was there as a dental technician. And I was there for 1 year.
1 year.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and then...
And then I left there and I went to Pease Air Force Base in New Hampshire.
Okay, for?
For 2 years. And I left there and I
went... What were you doing there?
General technician.
Okay, and then
And then I left there and I went to Osan Air Force Base, Korea. And I was there for 1 year.
All right.
And when I left Osan, I went to... I went to Pease Air Force. I don't know where I went. Maybe I went to, I don't know. I'm turning around now.
That's okay. That's all right. Because all the, this part of the interview is really about jogging your memory anyway.
Oh, yeah.
So it's okay.
When I left, where am I now? Osan?
Uh-huh.
When I left Osan, I think I probably went to... I don't know. I may have went to MacDill Air Force Base.
MacDill is in
Tampa, Florida. Yeah.
Right, yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And then when I left MacDill Air Force Base in Tampa, I went to Zaragoza, Spain.
How long were you in MacDill?
4 years.
4 years. What were you doing there?
I was a dental technician.
And then you went to Spain?
Yes, I went to Spain.
Where?
In Zaragoza.
Okay.
For four years.
North, south, east, or west?
South of Madrid.
South of Madrid.
Uh-huh. So and I was there for 4 years as a dental technician.
Okay.
And so when I left Zaragoza, Spain, I went to Grand Forks Air Force Base.
In North Dakota?
In North Dakota as a dental technician.
How long were you there?
I was there for 2 years. And when I left there, I went to Upper Heyford Air Force Base in England. And I was there for 4 years.
How far is that from London?
An hour.
Hour. Plane. Okay, that's not far. About 60 miles or so?
Yeah.
Okay, approximately?
Yeah.
Let the plane go by here, a helicopter. And, okay, was that your last duty base in England?
No, when I left England after 4 years, now it's Marcus and I, my son's with me now.
Okay.
So when I left there, I went to Columbus Air Force Base, Mississippi. And that's where I retired from in 1992.
What did you do there?
Dental technician.
Okay. All right, now I think we got down pretty much every place you've been over the 17-year period?
20 years.
20 years. Okay, cool. All right, so now let's go back, and I want to talk about your experiences as you traveled halfway around the world. You know, as you went from, you know, what were your experiences, you know, with instructors, with officers, with your fellow airmen, you know, as you traveled? And in that time period, from 72 to 92?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, actually, when I went in the Air Force in 1972, it wasn't real popular for females to be in the military. So my first assignment was Wurfsmith Air Force Base in Michigan. And when I got there, it was only, I was the eighth female that was there. So it was totally different.
How many people were on the base? Talk about ratio.
I don't know. I can't tell you that.
Several hundred? Thousand?
Thousand, yeah.
Okay.
Several thousand, yeah.
Several thousand.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
But, you know, it was located in a real cold area, so it wasn't really a black community there.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so that was different because I'd never been in cold weather, for one thing, so that was my first cold assignment. So I didn't even own a jacket. But they supplied us with below zero clothing.
Right.
And because there was only a few females here, they had the security people watch over the dorm.
Right.
Because there was only eight of us.
Right.
Uh-huh. So.
Eight total?
Mm-hmm. Females.
Period. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. And several thousand men.
Well, yeah. Seems like 7,000 men, yeah.
7,000?
I don't know. Okay. Just seems like a whole bunch.
I gotcha. Mm-hmm.
I guess one of the finer parts of my being in the service was I played sports. So I played, before I went in the Air Force, I played tennis. So I played, when I got to Europe, I played on the varsity tennis team.
Okay.
So in Spain. So because I was on the varsity team, we got to travel to Greece and Italy and places like that, and we were supported by the Air Force. And the other part of my contribution was I played volleyball, so I played on the base volleyball team. So
right.
being on the base volleyball team, we got to travel. That's when I was stationed in Zaragoza.
Uh-huh.
So I got to travel the other European countries. And then when I was in Upper Hayford, England, I played racquetball.
So what were the other European countries that you got to visit?
I went to Greece, Italy, France, Andorra.
Andorra, where the heck is that?
Andorra is a little country that sits down at the tip of Spain.
Oh, okay.
And I've been to Morocco, and when I was in, when I was stationed in Upper Hayford, I had a friend from Uganda.
Uh-huh.
So I went to Uganda, but we went by road as opposed to by plane. So we went through the tribes down to Kenya.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
And so on the way back from Kenya, I was stopped in Ethiopia.
Yeah.
And so that's probably a trip I'd never want to do again, is going to Africa. Because I went through the bush as opposed to as a tourist. So the experience was like totally different, like not really being welcome there.
Really?
Yeah. And so,
So you went where you, I just want to clarify, you went as a tourist or not as a tourist?
Not as a tourist.
Not as a tourist.
Not as a tourist.
Just someone visiting, traveling through there.
Yeah, so my friend said that, I said, do you live in the country or do you live in the city? She says, oh, I live in the city. So we went, when we got to Uganda, by way of bicycle and by way of cars, when I got to Uganda, I was like so surprised because she said she lived in the city. But to me, that wasn't really the city because to go to the bathroom, it was outside. And to take a bath, it was all outside. And the house that she lived in, it was from when Idi Amin had gone through there and blew everything up and went in and robbed everything. So that at her house, there were still holes in the walls, you know. So, and I, you know, they weren't really, really nice to me.
Did they have outhouses when you say you went outside? Or
outside, yeah. Just outside with a hole, you know, outside. Outside of the sleeping.
Right.
Yeah.
But were there outhouses or not?
Well, I had outhouses. We had outhouses when I was a kid. So it was a separate little closet.
Yeah.
But the outhouse that they had was a closet away from the house, but instead of having a toilet to sit on, you just had to squat over the hole.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
So, it was in 1975 when I was stationed at Wordsmith Air Force Base. It's when I met Charles, who was also stationed at Wordsmith at the same time.
Right, and where's Wordsmith again?
In Michigan.
Right, okay.
So then we got married, and so later on, I went back to get my kids.
Mm-hmm. From where?
From
Lauderdale?
Marcus was in Pompano with his grandmother,
uh-huh.
And my daughter was in Orlando at first with my aunt.
Right.
My aunt is the one who, that's my mother's sister.
Right.
And so she agreed to just keep, they agreed to keep my kids until I was situated to come and get my kids.
Right.
However, mm-hmm. I went to get Marcus from his grandmother. Marcus is 4 now. And then when I went to get Chrissy was no longer at my aunt's house. She was at another aunt's house because this aunt taught school and it was time for her to go back to school, so she thought that she should take her to my other aunt's house. Well, the aunt that she took her to, she had lost her daughter some years ago.
Right.
And so when she got my daughter, Chrissy just reminded her so much of her daughter, and it was like that void that she had lost.
Right.
So I did contact him. I said, we're coming to get Chrissy.
Right.
And so she said, my aunt says, well, if you come and get Chrissy, we're going to get together and say that you're an unfit mother because we don't want you to have Chrissy back. So these are my mother's siblings. So,
yeah.
So there was about 9 of them. So we said, well, we're coming to get Chrissy anyway. So we went to get Chrissy. Chrissy is 5. She's 5. I think she said Chrissy was 7.
Right.
5 or 7. So we went to get Chrissy at my aunt's farm. They were all there. All my mother's brothers and sisters and cousins and everything on the farm. And so I said, well, I came to get Chrissy. So they said, well, you're not going to get Chrissy. So my uncle came out with the shotgun and said that we need to leave the property. We either leave the property or it was going to be some trouble. And he wanted us to leave without Chrissy. So I was trying to take her, pulling her on one arm, and my aunt had her on the other arm. And so it just got to be just a bit much. So we went into town, and I got an attorney. And so we went to see the family court judge. We went to see him to have a talk with him. So he said, you need to get out of town. Because if you wanted your child, you shouldn't have given the child away. So he says, don't waste your money because you're not going to get her, so you may as well leave town. So I contacted my friend who was an attorney. He says, well, why don't you just kidnap her? He says, all you got to do is get her past the county line. But my aunt never had legal custody of her. So we said, well, we better not do that because it might be too traumatic for Chrissy. So it just got to be really, really bad. And right. So, you know, it wasn't that my aunt was taking her because she was being malicious. She was taking her because she truly loved her.
Yeah.
You know, and she thought that she could give her a better life. Because, you know, in our culture, it's not unusual to have an aunt raise a child. And, you know, because in my family, there's five of us, but there's three of us that was raised by the aunts.
Gotcha.
So it just got to be a bit much for my aunt, got to be a bit much for Chrissy, so I didn't want to take her through all that, so we left.
Uh-huh.
And then they kind of changed the rule about you could have the dependents. So I found out that I had all that back pay money.
Okay.
You know, when I found out, oh, you can have children. You can
for having a dependent.
Yeah.
That money. Gotcha.
That money, yeah. Mm-hmm. So they gave me back all that back pay money. So I distributed, I gave my aunt part of the money, and I gave Marcus's grandmother part of the money.
Which aunt?
The aunt that took Chrissy away from me.
Uh-huh.
I gave her that money, but I always sent money for Chrissy.
Right.
You know? So, you know, and I always went to visit her, but it was always guarded because she always thought if I leave her by herself that she's going to take her.
Right.
But, so, when we had the big tug war, I said to Chrissy, what do you want to do? And she says, I want to stay. So.
Keep going.
Take that off.
Okay. If I stop it,
okay,
it'll take forever to start again.
So I let her stay.
Okay.
And so,
where is she now?
She lives, well, actually, she lives in Atlanta. And so, you know, I stayed, I always visit her when I could, you know, when I was home, always visit her, always send her money. And so on one of the visits, I found out that my aunt never cashed any of the checks.
Your aunt?
Mm-hmm. She never cashed those checks because she didn't want it to say that, you know, that I had contributed.
Right.
Because when I spoke to the lawyer, he says, you have to give her back all that money. So she wants back all her money where she took care of. She has tallied it up for all the babysitting, and she's tallied up all the clothes and all the medical. So she wants that money.
So
aunt said, she said, I want that money.
Uh-huh.
And I said, well, then tell me how much it is. Because she had never cashed those checks.
Right.
Because that was part of her defense that I'm going to say, well, you know.
That there was no money that you sent.
There was no money, and that I deserted her, and I was an unfit mother. So Chrissy really thought I was this bad person.
Yeah.
You know, all those years, she thought I was this terrible person because when I had her, I had not finished high school.
Right.
And when I went in the Air Force, all I had was a GED. But while I was in the Air Force, I managed to, you know, get an associate's degree, get a bachelor's degree, and, you know, and that's not the person that they portrayed me to be.
Right.
You know, they portrayed me, well, she had a kid, she wasn't married, she didn't, you know, so they had portrayed me as being this person that Chrissy really, did, you know, thought I was.
Right.
So, so then when Chrissy got about 16, and she didn't really want to, you know, you get 16, you get a little boyfriend and all this stuff. So now, my aunt has these rules. Chrissy doesn't really want to follow these rules now. So now she's calling me, writing me, saying she want me to come and get her. And I said, I can't do that. I said, because, she's raised you, and you all had this good relationship, and she's taking care of you. So I can't do that. I can't come and get you now because you don't want to follow the rules. So then it was like, well, why did you keep Marcus and you didn't keep me? I want you, you know, it was like she was playing this game.
Right.
So anyway, you know, Ma took good care of Chrissy, and Chrissy had made good grades. Chrissy took music lessons. Chrissy sang in the choir. I mean, she really did take, you know, really good care of her.
Mm-hmm.
So, and she went, when she graduated, she was in college. So I went to her, you know, I was always there. I went to her recitals. I went to her graduation from high school. You know, I was always there, you know.
Right.
So when I got stationed at, you know, we were riding backwards and forward. You know, we always kept contact with the Calder or whatever. But it was always this thing about you kept Marcus and you didn't keep me. But it wasn't really that, you know.
Right.
But, you know, when your kids, it is what it is. You know, if that's the way she felt it, then that's the way it was.
Right,
you know.
Yeah.
So when I got stationed at my last assignment, which was in 1991 at Columbus Air Force Base, I was only like 4 hours from her in Atlanta.
Uh-huh.
By now she's married and she has a child. And so from there, I tried to build a mother-daughter relationship. And,
right.
Now we're good friends, good mother and daughter. We see
good.
Each other all the time. We talk every day. And
good.
And so, and so you know.
I was hoping for a happy ending.
Oh, yeah, real happy ending. And so okay. What I didn't say was that I'm also a disabled veteran.
Oh.
Did you need to know that?
Yeah, Well, we're going to talk about it. They ask you, were there any injuries?
Well, I'm a disabled veteran, and I have 90%, but part of my injuries are from playing sports.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But you played for the service.
Yes, I played for the service, so I have a few injuries, and then my last part just got up to 90% because there's all type of post-traumatic stress.
Right.
But I think a lot of the things are male-oriented. And they don't always, that's just my feeling because I was in such long ago. And there's a lot of things that affect females that were never taken into consideration or never brought to the boys' attention. So, a few years ago, I applied for depression and they said, well, we don't see any proof in your records because it has to be documented that you were treated for when you were in the military.
Right.
But I do know that, because Charles and I were separated, we lived separate for 10 years because he got out, I decided to stay because that was my plan to stay and retire. So Charles got out of the Air Force and so we lived separate for 10 years. We did the visit to 6 months and then Charles decided, well, you know, I don't think I really want to do this anymore. So then Charles filed for divorce. And so then I tried to get out of the Air Force. Mm-hmm. I applied to get out, and then when I went home, and I was like, I don't think I want to get out, so they disapproved my request for discharge because they said, we just spent all this money sending you to Spain, and we sent all your stuff, and we're not going to let you out right now, which was good.
Gotcha.
Okay? So when it came time for me to, needless to say, Charles went to court and changed his mind, said he didn't think he wanted to do that. So when it came time for getting time for me to retire, even though I could tell during the service, during the Christian thing, I was starting to have problems focusing.
Uh-huh.
You know, so I think playing the sports and keeping myself fit and eating right is really what got me through those times.
Right.
You know, because being in the medical field, and not only that, there's so many stigmas attached to depression. You know, people, you know, they think you're crazy and they say mental health illness, so you kind of keep your stuff to yourself. You
right.
know, that really wasn't so popular back then to go to see a psychiatrist or to go for therapy. So you just kind of deal with things. So, as I was saying, part of my disability was, you know, I when it was getting near for me to get out, I could feel things changing. You know, I was having problems focusing and I could tell something was going on.
Okay.
So I remember going to the doctor and saying, you know, it's getting time for me to get out and feels like I'm on a roller coaster. And he says, oh, well, you know, that happens when it's come time to get out because now you're talking about adjusting to a whole different environment.
Right.
And so, So what happened was I applied for disability, part of my disability, saying, you know, I'm depressed, I'm having problems, I'm not really adjusting well. And so the VA disapproved it, said, we don't see any documentations where you were treated. So what I did was I took the, some years went past, so I took the copy of the court documents that against my aunt, trying to get my daughter back.
Right.
And I took the copy of the divorce papers that Charles had served me, and I just sat down one day and I just poured my heart out, and it got approved. So that's how I got the 9%. So they gave me the 30% for depression.
Okay.
Now, what else you want to
know? Okay.
Now that I poured my heart out.
That's just fine. So you weren't in any wartime situations?
No, I was in doing Desert Storm. So at that time I was stationed in Upper Haber, but we really was a support group. You know, I wasn't physically in those areas, but
okay.
We were the support group for Desert Storm. So when I went in the Air Force, it was 1972, but it was toward the end of the Vietnam War, which ended in 1975.
Right. Okay, being a support...
Medical. Because during wartime, you're not a dental technician. You're a medical person then.
Okay.
Yeah. So we had training to, you know, take care of the wounds and triage and those things.
This is where I'm going.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know whether it's from your unit or if your unit was a medical unit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but you did all your treatment in England.
Yeah.
For people who had been wounded.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah,
so,
which really wasn't that bad. I think
I want to know what happened. Did you see a lot of casualties?
No. Most of the accidents we saw were from sports injuries or, you know, no serious injuries.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not from the soldiers coming back from Desert Storm?
They were at Desert Storm, but the injuries weren't life-threatening injuries.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Were you awarded any medals or citations? And for what?
Yeah, well, I have, you know, the usual ones. I can't think of them right now. You know, the usual ones that you get?
Yeah, that's fine. The basics.
Yeah, the basic. Except I have an expert shooting ribbon.
Sharpshooter? Uh-oh. Anyway.
We ran out of time?
No. I was just saying, you know how to use a gun. I'm only kidding. How did you, you stayed in touch with your family via mail and phone. How'd you stay in touch with your family?
From where?
From all the places you were, the whole time, over 20 years being
out in the world.
Oh,
yeah. Well, you know, we always had 30 days leave.
Right.
Plus the holidays. So I always came back on holidays. There's always phone calls and letters.
Okay. So how was the food? I already know. How was the food, basically, from place to place to place?
Well, the food was actually pretty good. Because back then, the military cooked the food.
Right.
You know, as opposed to now, I think they all contracted out.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you have plenty of supplies?
Yes.
Throughout? Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. Okay, you'll love this question. Did you feel stress or pressure over the 20-year period?
Not from the military.
Really? Just outside?
Yeah, because actually, being in the Air Force, they always say that's not really like the military. And being a medic, so we always had everything we needed.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, again, from base to base to base, what were some of the things that you did for recreation or entertainment?
Well, the base provided their own entertainment. We had the NCO club.
Right.
But I always had the sports that kept me involved.
Uh-huh.
The racquetball, the tennis, the volleyball. And so, and then my son, Marcus, was with me. So Marcus played all the sports, too.
Okay.
You know, soccer, baseball, and so there was always entertainment.
Great. Did you collect a lot of photos?
Yes. I have photos, lots of photos.
All right. Well, we might share those sometime. But at any rate, did you keep a personal diary?
No, because I have it all here.
Okay. All right, tell me about the last days in service.
Well, my last days, I was stationed at Columbus Air Force Base in Mississippi.
Uh-huh.
Ironically, I'd gone to school there when I left, when I got my GED.
Right.
There was a school there called Mary Holmes Junior College.
Uh-huh.
And at that school, there was 400 black kids.
Okay.
And so when I got my GED from the University of Miami, I went there. And I had a Mexican friend, and she wanted to go also. And I said, you can't go because there's only 400 black kids. So she blew her hair out, and she says, no, I'm going to come too. So when I went there, there was a lot of racial problems. I remember going in the store with her, and they're not serving us because it's me and her. And the most memorable thing I remember is that we were walking one day, and it rained, and the truck came over and splashed us all with the mud. So I said, I'll never, God, please don't ever let me come back here again. And that was the last place that I was stationed. So when I left England, I got sent right back to that place in West Point, Mississippi.
Okay.
But when I went back this last time, it was one of the best assignments that I had.
Okay.
Yeah, the people were nice, and you know, I went back to visit the school, so I kind of ended up where I started out.
No more rain and no
more
water
rain and
hosing. Okay, good. All right, so now you're out of the service. What did you do immediately, you know, when you got out? Tell me about education, GI Bill.
Well, actually...
Are you finished with your education?
No, actually I had a few more classes to do. So I finished those classes, then I got my bachelor's degree from St. Leo's College, which is over, there was an extension at MacDill Air Force Base, but they really outside of Tampa.
Okay.
And then I thought I would try to become a dental hygienist because that's really where my passion was. But it was just a bit much. So then I left Tampa because I couldn't find a job.
Uh-huh.
And so I moved over to West Palm Beach in 1995.
Right.
And I started working for Department of Juvenile Justice. And so I tried to get into the dental hygiene program, and at Lake Worth Junior College.
Yeah. Palm Beach Junior College, which
is in Lake Worth.
Right, right.
The guy that I was stationed with in Upper Hayford, England, he was in charge of the dental hygiene program.
At Palm Beach State,
yes.
With us today, Palm Beach State College.
Yes.
Gotcha.
He was in charge of the dental hygiene program.
Mm-hmm.
So he was going to, because they were only taking like 30 out of 400 people to get into the program.
Right.
But he knew my experience in the military, so he had accepted me into the program.
Great.
And so the classes were grueling because they were chemistry and, you know, those type of classes. But because I was having this problem focusing.
Right.
I had problems with the classes. And not only that, I got breast cancer.
Oh.
So I said, well, you know, I already have this degree in sociology. I may as well take this and do whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So then I started, I got the job with the Department of Juvenile Justice, and I supervised the house arrest program for a while. And then I, in 2004, I left there, and I taught school at one of the alternative schools.
Right.
And from there, I went to Department of Financial Services, where I am insurance analysis. So that's where I am right now.
That's where you are now. Okay. Obviously, I'm pretty sure. I'll just ask this back to back.
Mm-hmm.
Did you make any close friendships, and are you still friends?
I made close friends, and we're still friends.
Yes. And from the service?
From the service.
One okay.
Yep.
All right. Yeah. So still today, you know, you still got
today.
Those. Good.
Yes.
And did you join any veterans organizations? I know the answer to that is already yes.
Uh-huh.
VFW?
VFW.
Right.
And the Disabled Veteran Association.
Okay. I know there's another question related to that is, do you attend reunions? Military?
No.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I already know what you did for your career after the war. You told me Department of Juvenile Justice. Two or three questions. Did your military experience influence your thinking about war or about the military in general?
The military in general. Because I just think that, you know, without the military, I don't know where I'd be. So I think that's one of the best choices that I made.
Overall, it was a great experience.
Yes, great experience, yeah.
What is, just tell me some of the experience, activities that, that you participate in with your VFW.
Well, we have monthly meetings.
Uh-huh.
And I'm on the honor guard team, which means we do ceremonies.
Right.
We open up ceremonies. There's seven of us.
Uh-huh.
On the team that I'm on.
Right.
So, and that team does funerals. It does. We go to senior citizens facilities.
Right.
We do Martin Luther King parades and just whatever it is, you know, to support the veterans.
Great. Last question. Is there anything you would like to add that we have not covered in this interview?
No.
Well, I want to thank you so much for a great interview. It's been wonderful. Okay, and that's about the size of it as soon as I can find the stop button.